Alrighty. Well, welcome everyone. It's 2 o'clock, so we are going to get started with our fourth and final virtual Julmarknad Day panel. This is display every day, so you're all very welcome. We're really excited to be joining our artists from their homes and studios. So this is really fantastic to make lemonade out of a crazy year, and get to see where people actually work. One of the things that's so wonderful about going to a market is getting to meet the artists in person. And since we really were feeling like we were going to miss that this year, not knowing how the markets would go, the virtual market, we created these panels, and they have been super fun. I don't know if a few of you have gotten to join into other panels so far today, and I hope that you enjoyed the other conversations as well. But if like a couple of you maybe joined in every panel, you got to meet almost all of our artists, which I think is really a sweet thing to be able to do in this moment when we aren't able to see each other in person. So with that, I really would like to welcome Tara Sweeney. She's going to be our host for this panel. And Tara's going to be kind of running the conversations, keeping us all in line for the next half hour. And I am going to be here on the back end as tech support and making sure that everyone's web links get into the chat so you can follow up about those amazing artists that you're hearing from, take a look at their social media pages, follow them so that you can keep in touch with them throughout the year, and of course check out their web stores. So with that, I'm going to introduce Tara, and Tara Sweeney is a Twin Cities based illustrator and the author of a children's book, a wonderful illustrated book that she created with her son. And that was the inspiration for a exhibit that opened in February at the American Swedish Institute and was supposed to close this summer and is now closing in January. So we hope that you have gotten to check out some of the exhibit either virtually or in person in the year that it's been with ASI. And Tara is also a practicing artist and instructor all over the Twin Cities and beyond. So she really has a lot of experience working with artists at kind of all levels of their journeys. And we're excited to have her lead these conversations. So with that, I'm gonna dip out and turn it over to Tara.
All right. Thank you, Erin. Thank you, ASI. Thank you all artists for joining this conversation today. And I'm gonna start off with Susan from Simply Elegant Glass. Susan, would you introduce us to your work and then tell us a little bit about your inspirations?
Absolutely, be happy to. Welcome everybody, and thanks for joining us today. My name is Susan Tracy. I'm a glass and jewelry artist, and my company is Simply Elegant Glass Art, and I live in Excelsior. My studio is actually in an unheated garage, which today is pretty cold, so I'll spare you shivering out there. So I'm in my office today, and I've been a glass and jewelry artist for over 10 years now, and I make art in several categories to display, to wear, and to use every day. I'm inspired by, I'd say, three main things. First is nature. I've always loved the beauty of nature, and especially love the fall foliage. I grew up in New England. And so I incorporate Japanese maple leaves like this into some of my art. And this is a silver pendant that's actually a maple leaf gets pressed into it. I also use other types of leaves and put them into plates like this. And those are actually real leaves. And these leaves from the Arboretum. So those are plates, and I make wall vases that can hold things from nature, like dried and fresh flowers and plants. And these are, you can hang on your wall, and those are always fun. And secondly, I'm inspired by pretty shiny things. I'm a Swedish descent, and my mother had lots of pretty shiny things, a lot of glass in the house. So I say I have the Swedish glass gene. So I make things like very simple crystal pendants and star ornaments in a huge variety of colors. And I also make glass tunta in traditional red and white, and also in, we now have blue and green and gold and all kinds of colors because people have asked for, gee, I have your two, can you make some more? So we've come up with new colors. Finally, I'm inspired by learning new techniques from gifted instructors at workshops across the country. This year it's become virtual. Usually I travel, but I love to learn things and improve skills and incorporate new techniques into my art. And this year I learned a new technique for fused glass, where you apply pressure in addition to heat in creating the pieces. And this makes the piece thinner and more delicate. And this bowl is actually on display virtually right now in the at MIA in the Foot in the Door exhibit. Wow. So please visit my website, look at our collections, and thanks so much for stopping by.
Thank you, Susan. I have another question for you. Why particularly the Japanese maple leaf? Why is that iconic for you?
This is actually, I like maple leaves because of the color in the fall. This particular leaf is from one of my best friends in Massachusetts, her backyard. I mean, I was visiting them and this tree was just glorious. And I said, can I have some, because, you know, I'm taking leaves off the ground, so they're just going to go back into nature. And so I went out there and collected. And of course, I set them plate afterward. So you can just take one of the little leaves and that makes a nice piece of jewelry. So this is actually just one of the pieces. So it works really well. And there's smaller ones too, but there's nothing more meaningful than that. It's just that it's colorful and pretty and it appealed to me. So good question. Like
versatile as well. I'm curious, you're from New England originally, and now you're based in Minnesota, and we're a really natural state. So I'm curious if there's a particular place in Minnesota that's a muse for you or an inspiration. Have you found
it? I would say the lakes in general. I grew up with the ocean and we don't have an ocean here, but the lakes are pretty good. So we live on one. I'm fortunate to be able to, people say, oh, how often do you use your lake? Every day we look at it. So that I would say is, you know, one of the reasons we chose to live here.
Okay. Thanks so much, Susan.
Thank you.
All right, Julie. Of J. Renee Benda is your company. Julie, would you introduce us to your work and tell us about your inspirations or your process?
Oh, sure. Hi, thank you. Good to see everyone here. My name is Julie Benda. I go by J. Renee Benda, and I'm a printmaker by training, but I also do work in wood carving and sculpture. And currently, I am in my studio in Northeast Minneapolis that I share, and it's nice and quiet here today, which is good. Sometimes the radiators are going off, and that would have made for a rough interview. But for the Julmarknad sale, I have a series of screen prints that were kind of just specially curated for the holidays and for kind of, you know, fun, lively spirit. My work is very much inspired by the natural world. I grew up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. I'm a Youper, born and raised, and I kind of feel like most of my childhood was spent trying to perform for an audience of pine and birch trees. So as an artist now, I think that it infuses my work, whether it's in print or working with wood itself. Just basically, I do a little bit of teaching over at Minneapolis College of Art and Design and occasional workshops. I love working with other people. I think that collaboration is one of my favorite things to do. And that's kind of me summarized.
Julie, I've got some questions for you. So I did a little reading on you. I'm an alum of MCAD, did my MFA there. It's a fabulous institution. But I see that you intermittently publish a comic, right?
I do, yes. Correct. So I'm curious
about that, but I'm curious about, it's just, it surprised me when I saw that, and I love it. I love being surprised, but I'm curious. It's not necessarily a funny comic. I haven't looked at the comic, but I'm curious about the role of humor or storytelling, because I think that is a really big piece of comedy, of how that connects back up with your printmaking. If it does, I'm making an assumption. Yeah.
Oh no, I think good detective work. but yeah, I do write a comic. It is supposed to be funny.
I am going to check it out. Is,
yeah. Well, I'll just briefly say it's about a creatively unfulfilled beaver named Frank. As he ventures out into the arts community and kind of navigates the limitations of his pond life within that. And so it is very much taken from every single phase of my life, whether it's growing up in the middle of the woods or going to art school and just being like, what am I doing here? And it is published by McSweeney's Internet Tendency out of San Francisco. And so but that was a great example for me of recognizing maybe the joy and humor I like to bring to my work. I think that whether even in some of my very serious wood carvings, I like to make sure there's a surprise there for someone to discover, because I think in storytelling, which is sort of my through line for all of my work, is that you are inviting somebody into the story, and how do you want to invite them? And I think I like to invite through sort of that unusualness or like little bit of humor or nod. So.
All right, thank you so much for taking that on, and I can't wait to check out the comic. Your work is beautiful. Thank you. Stanley.
Thank you.
Stanley.
Hello.
Hello, could you introduce us to your work? Tell us about your process and your inspirations.
Yeah, so I'm Stanley, as you guys know, Stanley Leonard, and I am also a printmaker. I do woodcut relief prints. And so I'll just give you a brief rundown of how I make a print from start to finish, because it kind of is a really cool process and says a lot. But everything I do, you know, first starts off with an idea, sketching, and then it goes on to a blank block of wood. And from there, I will take that design and take hand carving tools such as, you know, some of these guys here. Mostly small tools, because I carve in a lot of detail, and I will carve that image into the block. So, for example, here is a block that was carved. I'm going to try and get this closer here, so you can kind of see the depth of the carving. It's not carved too deep, but pretty much all I'm doing is taking away the surface of the wood so that when I roll it with ink and then press that onto a sheet of paper, I get a nice print. So for that block, this right here is the final print. Now this one is a multiple color, so this went through the press 7 times to layer up different layers of color from 4 separate wood blocks. So there were some color reduction blocks, which just means I print a color, then I'll carve more away from that block, ink it in a different color, and then print again. And then also multiple blocks where it was just a separate block. And that's pretty much my process. And I've been doing woodcuts since I was in college. Just kind of got my toes wet there and just kept rolling ever since, and picking up new things, taking some classes where I could, and just doing everything I could do to learn and grow and just keep making more and more.
All right. Stanley, I have a question for you.
Yes.
I notice when I do a little sleuthing on you that you are also a photographer.
Yeah.
So I'm curious. So my question is, how does your photography inform your printmaking?
That's a great question. I actually use photography now more as a tool for inspiration and image generation, just because it's a very natural medium for me to look at the world and everything and be able to pick out composition and color and shape and all those things. You know, if I just look out there, I can see all those things, but then being able to capture it within a frame really helps me to put those elements in perspective to kind of then turn those into two-dimensional art. And for a while there, you know, I was really trying to pursue both avenues of doing photography and doing woodcut art and doing this and doing that. And I've always been kind of Quicksilver and interested in a lot. But in the last couple of years, I've through some real struggles, I've dedicated myself to focus and hone in on just working on woodcuts. But I still use photography as a real strong tool in my process.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, next I'd like to hear from Juan and Yua of Third Daughter, Restless Daughter. And I'm assuming that you're going to work out who speaks first. I'm not sure, but we'd love to hear about your inspirations, introduce us to your work and also to how you collaborate, because that's another piece.
Well, we're a sister duo, so she's not going to get to speak today. I'm kidding. I actually started the company solo about 5-6 years ago. I was looking for cheap Christmas gifts for my friends, and I decided to make some. And our grandmother was very prolific at doing bandao and Hmong cross stitching. And Hmong cross stitching is very similar to American style cross stitching. So I incorporated that into the pieces. And, you know, it was techniques that our grandmother passed down to our mother, who doesn't do it anymore because she's going blind due to diabetes. So we are kind of passing along that tradition to ourselves too. And then I got really busy. So Juan and I partnered together and our business has really flourished now with two people working on it. So,
I was going to say that most of our things are, I mean, it's inspired by humor and pop culture really. So a couple of things that I wanted to show was like, this was one of our first piece that it's still very true to today and true to almost any artist out there. It says, never give up on your stupid dream. Because it's just, you know, it's everyone has a dream. And then as we work, I mean, we do things very similar to this one, if you can see it. It's two skeletons who are holding hands, and we call it Forever Skeleton. So, and it's, this one takes a long time to do for sure. But over the last couple of years, we've actually also expanded into different, still falling within like the fiber art medium, but also doing things that such as, you know, creating murals and installations. So like there's a restaurant in Northeast called Central, and it has like a 8 feet by maybe 10 feet size. It's in the wall. So it's like, it's a grid with like yarn stitching on it. And so it's a floral print. We have like at the M, in St. Paul, we have in the women's restroom, we painted the walls, created pieces, and we have also done this chicken wire installation with like yarn. So we lately, I mean, that's like trying to things on a bigger scale and taking cross stitches to that next level.
Huh. It's fascinating to think about scale, because cross stitch in its, at least in my experience of it, is a really intimate art, and it's within 10 to 20 inches. So that's wonderful. And I did notice that you use humor pretty extensively in all your pieces. I'm curious, and I hope you won't mind if I ask if your grandmother was alive or still is alive and she's seen your work.
She's actually not seen our work, and I'm actually named after our grandmother. So I, you know, hope to carry on that tradition. She passed in 2003. So she's
okay.
But I mean, you know, I just remember sitting and watching her kind of hunched over her little monk stool and working so hard on it. So,
yeah. Well, perhaps she's watching in a different way.
Yeah. Yep.
Thank you very much. And next, I'd like to hear from Kelsey of Kelzuki. And Kelsey, would you say, would you introduce us to your work and tell us where your ideas come from?
Yeah, so my name's Kelsey Oside. Kelzuki is the name of my business, and I'm an illustrator. I make mostly like 99% animal art with sometimes a little bit of fungi. I just love big visual taxonomies, you know, inspired by vintage school charts, that sort of animal encyclopedia look. So I'll just hold up some of the paintings that are around me. I started this series in 2016, so coming up on five years painting animal species, originally daily. Got a zebra here. I try to keep up a daily practice, but I also have a toddler, so that doesn't always necessarily hold. But
it's a different daily practice.
It's a different type of daily practice right now. But I choose a taxonomic group, if you're familiar with animal taxonomy, to focus on each, usually month. So currently I'm working on a hawk and raptor set. So this is a, oh my gosh, a Budeo, what is this called? This is a buzzard I painted today, and a kite from recently. So I do these little gouache paintings. They're painted by hand, almost always in this 5x7 size. And then I collect them into digital prints, which are part of this greater series, which is now I think numbering like 26 or 27 versions. So I have a few of the newer ones. I've actually shown these at a fair at ASI in the past, but these are some of the new ones I've done since. So this is bats that we did for Halloween this year. And we have salamanders, which was like a interesting divisive one. Some people were kind of grossed out by this, but I thought it was pretty cool to do. Cephalopods, which are squids and octopus, and nautilus. So yeah, it's just something that I've always loved since I was a kid. And I think it sometimes can really strike a nice nostalgic note with other people who really love that animal encyclopedia feeling and kind of love the idea of collecting or displaying their favorite animal in their home. So that's my work.
Thank you. Kelsey, I have a confession to make. I grew up with salamanders as pets, but my dad was a biologist, so there's a reason.
That's so cool.
White rats, too.
Lovely. Everybody's favorite.
So, I don't know what that says about me, but there it is. I'm curious, on a process level, why you choose gouache over watercolor or whether you mix them together. I'm a watercolor artist, and I'm fascinated by gouache, but I've never even dipped my toe in it.
Oh my gosh. Well, I love that question. This animal series that began 5 years ago really happened when I switched to gouache. Oh. And I am trained as a watercolor artist semi-formally. I had taken some classes actually at the Minnesota School of Botanical Art, which teaches traditional botanical painting, which is I think why I sort of came around to this format of like the isolated species on a white background. That's what is taught in traditional botanical painting. The watercolor in that space is very controlled and very meticulous and layered. And I just don't have that. It's something I admire so much in others. I do not have the patience. So when I found gouache, I think this project really exploded out of me because I finally felt like I had a medium that I could work quickly with and produce a lot of volume. I clearly have a little bit of obsessive tendencies and love to just go for it, animal every day. And I love gouache because it's opaque. You can pick it back up again, so you can re-wet it. If anybody's not familiar, it's a type of paint similar to watercolor paint, but not as permanent and usually used in like more commercial applications, which to me, I don't necessarily see that as a downside. I see that as an upside. So I think it's just it felt right for me. I really enjoy how loud it is. And I think it's just for something that intuitively felt really right for me to be able to create a lot of work.
Well, I'm speaking for me, but I bet there are lots of us that are grateful you figured out your fit, because it looks like it's working for you.
Oh yeah, thank you. Well, if anybody's interested in trying gouache, I'm like the gouache evangelist.
You are the queen of gouache.
This is really fancy gouache, which has honey as a binder, but you can find gouache in all kinds of price tiers. And like, if you're interested in trying it out, I do recommend buying like a starter set. You'll get like 6 colors and just playing around with it. Cause for me, it's just been so fun to work with. And I know it's enjoying a renaissance with a lot of illustrators, and
yeah,
squash is the best.
Thanks, Kelsey. Okay, Peter, would you tell us about your work and your inspirations?
Well, so I make pottery, and it's stoneware pottery, which is kind of high fired pottery. And my work is all functional, which means, you know, it can be used in daily life. But I try to take it a little further than that, in that I'm really interested by the possibilities of that clay allows, where you can make almost any shape. And also the decorative possibilities that you can do also. And so it's just a medium that has these many possibilities and that you can do so many things with. I'm like a lot of other people, I'm inspired by nature, and I live out on the Mississippi River. It's really beautiful out here, and they're up here north of St. Cloud. There's a lot of nature, and the river's pretty clean, and so you can swim in it, and there's fish and birds, and so that's one of my main inspirations. And I've also been always interested in ancient art. And so there are so many wonderful pottery traditions from all over the world, the Chinese, the pre-Columbians, the Greeks. So I draw a lot of inspiration from that also.
Peter, would you say how long you have had your hands in clay?
Yeah, well, I started in college, and that was a long time ago. So I've been a professional potter for more than 40 years. And, you know, that gives you enough time to kind of develop your own style. And so that's happened to me. Over the years, I've figured out, you know, what really turns me on, certain shapes I like to make, and the way that I use my materials. And so, yeah, it's been a long time.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
Kim, would you tell us about your work and your inspirations?
There. Hi, well, I'm Kim with Open Cupboard Designs, and I have a fine art background and have worked as an illustrator and designer for my career. And I had an unfortunate personal tradition of making Christmas cards for all my friends since I was, I think, 16. And my father was a woodcut artist, so I did a lot of woodcuts and a lot of reduction blocks. Decided that I had created sort of a cast of characters who told little stories, and the process of doing woodblocks was getting a bit cumbersome, and so I decided to move on to an illustration technique that reminded me of my woodblocks origin, and I have kept going from there. So I think of my cards basically as short stories, and then I try to think of the illustration, if I could do one illustration for the story, what that illustration would be, and that ends up being the final design for the card. So they're very story oriented in one image. And from the cards, I moved on to creating luminaries. And also I have a Swedish dish towel this year. And I have experimented a little recently with watercolor batik. So this is a luminary that is done from a watercolor batik, and that's a traditional batik process, but you're using watercolor on rice paper with a hot wax resist. So that's a really fun technique.
It's very tactile.
Yes.
So maybe there's a connection to your early beginnings and how tactile the wood was.
But yeah, very much.
I have a quick quick question for you. And you mentioned that you started doing this by creating personal cards for your friends. So it was definitely a relationship-driven storytelling.
Yeah.
And I'm curious if there's one story in particular that has inspired maybe more than one image for you. Is there one special story that comes back to you?
Not really, more sort of a set of constraining values, sort of like a haiku has many rules and then you have to create within the boundaries okay. of that. And my sort of value structure is the idea that we are surrounded by nature. Nature isn't somewhere else, it's here around us and we should take care of it. And that within that structure of nature, we all act out our lives, and those personal relationships that we form are very much informed by this natural world that we lived in. So that sort of is the defines of all those stories.
All right. Thank you, Kim. Thank you, everybody, for sharing your work and your process with us, for putting up with my questions and my sleuthing that I did to figure out what you did. It was wonderful to be set loose on being curious about all of you. And it's just really wonderful to be in a virtual room with all of this great creative energy. I also want to thank everybody who's joining us to listen and adding their comments and questions to the chat. And I look forward to a year when I can bump into you in person at a Julmarknad. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, everyone, for joining
thank
us
you.
Today for this afternoon. It was really fun to see you all and connect after so much emailing and not personal connections so much. So with that, we will close out our final panel of our virtual Julmarknad day. And I just want to remind everyone who's watching that we have 33 incredible artists, businesses to visit at asimn.org. I'll put that in the chat. And that is where you'll find links to all of the artists' businesses that you heard from today. We're also inviting people to have some of the artists are offering local pickup at ASI next week. Our museum store is open, although the museum is closed, and you are welcome to check out that option as well, which is a great way to support the artists here in the Twin Cities. So we really appreciate your support in this crazy year, and we're gonna look forward to next year's Julmarknad and seeing you all in person. So take care, everyone, and have a great rest of your day.